Solutions.com.
21st Century Radio is sponsored by Hieronymus and Company. Now more of 21st Century Radio with your host, Dr. Zoe Hieronymus.
It's all about soul. It's all about faith and a deeper devotion. It's all about soul. Because under love is a stronger emotion.
Welcome to 21st Century Radio. I'm Dr. Zohara Hieronymus. Laura Kortner is our executive producer, and Anita Brockington, our engineer. You know, once upon a time, I was a daily talk show host between 1992 and 2002, and given that kind of airtime, I covered a wide range of topics, and one was space ascendancy, exploration in our future. And in 94, I had the privilege of breaking the carbonaceous meteorite from Mars story with our guests this hour, Dr. John Brandenburg, along with Vince DiPrito and Greg Molinar. Plasma physicist Dr. John Brandenburg, who recently joined my hubby, Dr. Bob Hieronymus, joins me this evening. He's a longtime colleague of 21st Century Radio, a consultant at Morningstar Applied Physics LLC, a part-time instructor of astronomy, physics, and mathematics at Madison College and other institutions in Madison, Wisconsin. He is as well author, among other titles, of a 2015 release, Dead Mars, Dying Earth, The Space Force Disclosure Politics from Adventures Unlimited. And to let you understand a little bit about why I trust Dr. Brandenburg and his opinions is previously when he worked at Orbital Technologies, it was on space plasma, nuclear fusion, advanced space propulsion. He is the principal inventor of MET, microwave electrothermal plasma thruster, and this fascinates me, using water propellant for space propulsion. Maybe we'll get a chance to talk about that. He's worked on so many things, SDI, the Clementine mission to the moon, rocket plume regolith interactions on the moon, and Mars vortex theory of rocket engine design, and the combined, I'll get this one, Sakharov-Kaluza-Klein theory of field unification for purposes of space propulsion and Mars, Mars science. All right, so we'll shorten this now. Mars holds a certain fascination for John, and he's here to share with us something I find fascinating, that he believes there were nuclear explosions on the surface of Mars that may have destroyed a civilization once there. We have to wonder, with NASA's insight now on the Martian surface to explore what's below, some of us wonder, will they find remains of a prior community, given there's evidence above ground of it? And might there even be millions of deceased Martians if they were bone-bound as we Earthlings are? Big time out there in space, John. Thank you so much for being with us.
Oh, it's wonderful to be here, Zoe. Thank you so much for having me on your show.
You're welcome. It's been a while. I mean, when I think about China going to the moon to grow potatoes, and there we up on Mars, you know, digging
don't
under... Let,
don't forget the silkworms.
Oh, right, and the silkworms.
And a plug for silk.
All right, so maybe you can first give us...
They also have a copy of the President for Life's thoughts that have now been inaugurated into the Chinese Constitution.
Really?
Yes.
That's interesting.
I'm just joking.
I know. I got it.
All right, history repeats itself often as farce.
Yeah, exactly. It becomes true if you say it long enough, right? So
right.
You and Nikola Tesla are two people who have claimed there has been life on Mars, a society, Nikola Tesla said, and he claimed much of his knowledge came from Martians telepathically. So talk to us about what you think has happened on Mars or what it is we're suspicious of having happened.
Well, my theory is a little bit more straightforward than Nikola Tesla's. It's just that Mars was like Earth for a long period geologic time. It had an ocean. It had a dense atmosphere, as evidenced by all the water channels and you know, flowing into an ocean basin. And it's bright red. And it turns out in order to have liquid water on Mars, you have to have a big carbon dioxide greenhouse. But that's chemically unstable because it'll form carbonates unless you add oxygen to it.
Huh.
Then it becomes chemically stable. And, of course, it then turns Mars red because Mars becomes highly oxidized, just like Earth. If you look at pictures of the Sahara Desert from Earth, from space, they're bright red.
Yeah.
So my belief was that Mars had very Earth-like conditions for a long period of geologic time, and it had life. That's how the oxygen got there, and ultimately developed an intelligent humanoid civilization similar to on Earth. You know, and it didn't have to be advanced. It could have been just Bronze Age. I think that's most likely.
Mm-hmm.
And then something catastrophic happened, and the atmosphere is loaded with a particular isotope called xenon-129 that is a basically forensic clue to it's only formed in nuclear explosions or supernova. And we know a supernova did not occur on Mars. So it has to have been a nuclear explosion. That's the only known cause. And we think we found the spots where the nuclear weapons went off. They were apparently very large and dropped from space and were airbursts. So we can actually do a lot of forensic analysis. The civilization looks like it was primitive, the face on Mars, and then there's another face at a place called Galaxis Chaos. And this is all in my book, by the way.
Right,
The book is Death on Mars, Life and Death on Mars. That's an earlier book. I've written three Mars books, basically. But Death on Mars is the most recent one that summarizes all this data. And I essentially got involved in the investigation because I wanted to end the Cold War. The Cold War was so dangerous. And you've never been through an international crisis till you've worked at a nuclear weapons lab.
Mm-hmm.
And you see people who are actually involved in the decision chain on whether to use nuclear weapons, walking around, dying of stress during these crises. And I worked at Livermore Lab, and finally I was working at Sandia National Labs in Albuquerque. And I just had this, and several other people also commented they just were deathly afraid we were going to have a nuclear war by accident.
Right.
In 1983, and we almost did. It came out later that we actually did almost have a war by accident, a nuclear war, in November of 1983. It was a program, it was a NATO war exercise called Able Archer, and I discussed this in the book, and the Russians thought it was a Trojan horse, that the war exercise was going to be actually be an invasion.
Mm-hmm.
And so, to make a long story short, when I saw the work of DiPietro Molinar on the day after Christmas in 1983, I immediately decided that I should help in the investigation because I thought this could help end the Cold War. And the Cold War will destroy us.
And you thought, was your thinking, John, that if we Earthlings understood that there had perhaps been a nuclear war on Mars and ended a civilization, that we would think twice about destroying ourselves?
On an intuitive level, it was later confirmed that Mars had this nuclear war signature in its atmosphere. At the time, it was, it was the idea that if we found out we were not the only humanoid civilization, that Mars had this humanoid dead civilization on it, that it would basically distract the human race from the Cold War and get it thinking down a new... We wanted to change the mode of thought, basically.
Uh-huh. And
so we did our best. And ultimately, we did find out that the nuclear weapons residue in the Martian atmosphere was present, and both the United States and the Soviet Union knew it was present. So we were ultimately presenting both superpowers with the most terrifying image imaginable. It was like the end of the Planet of the Apes, first Planet of the Apes movie, where they see the Statue of Liberty, the face of the Statue of Liberty poking above the sand.
Right.
You know, he realizes he's on Earth, that Earth has been devastated by a nuclear war. And so we basically presented that image to both superpowers.
And how do they respond?
Well, they started unraveling the Cold War after that. We think that this was one of the factors.
So
you know,
interesting.
I'm not going to pretend that me and my the group I worked with was the Independent Mars Investigation Team, and it was organized by Dick Hoagland. But we were one factor, we think, in making both the Soviet Union and the United States become aware that there was no safety net, that we could easily destroy this planet with a nuclear war, and that it may have already happened once.
Well, and of course, on Earth, of course, you know, we could have fault lines crack open where there are nuclear plants. We could have a, you know...
Sure. There, you know... well, you know...
Put it this way, there's enough nuclear...
What kind of person would build nuclear power plants in an area prone to very high, severe earthquakes?
Right. Idiots. Called humans. It's just so... And there's no place really in this country other than maybe, I forget which, Montana. But when you start talking like this and you go, okay, so there were hydrogen bombs on Mars, then you go, well, who did it? And when? And why?
Well, that's the big question. And I don't really have the answer to that. And as a scientist, we must always be careful not to say that we know more than we know.
Right.
I think we have found evidence for a humanoid, primitive humanoid civilization, you know, Bronze Age or, you know, ancient Egypt, Mayan, Olmec, something like that. We have found, and coincident with that, evidence for a long-lived Earth-like period of climate on Mars in geologic time. But as far as who apparently dropped two very large hydrogen bombs from space.
You said one bomb, I remember reading, as big as the Empire State Building.
Yeah, they were both about as big as the Empire State Building.
Good
one
God.
Was apparently larger than the other, but they were airbursts. They burst in midair. They didn't create big craters. They just created radioactive hot spots. And the hot spots, radioactive hot spots, are smooth. There's no crater there.
Mm-hmm.
And this is typical of an airburst, like the Hiroshima and Nagasaki explosions were airbursts, because that creates maximum shockwave damage to civilian structures. And so, I've now found that there's a meteorite called Allende that has the same, almost a carbon copy of the, you know, almost a exact duplicate of the Mars xenon abundance spectrum with this big peak at 129, only everyone says it's due to what's called R process in a supernova. So that was discovered in 1969. So everyone knew when they saw the... when they measured the xenon isotope distribution in the Mars atmosphere with the Viking landers in 1976, everyone knew what it meant.
So we're talking about a very long time period. I mean, from my vantage point, a long time period in the news, you know, cycle one day is a long time period. We're talking about a couple decades of...
I imagine the news, people as like a bunch of hummingbirds going from flower to flower. And no, they don't hover at any flower very long.
No, but these isotope masks that you're talking about, the xenon 129 and krypton, I think, and that, of course, makes me think of Superman.
Krypton is another one produced in large amounts in a nuclear weapon, and it's produced in a characteristic way, and I've been able to confirm that on Mars, too. But basically, by the way, the place where I was working... We had nuclear weapons experts, and I showed them all the data.
Right.
When I was putting together this research, and they all said, oh, yeah, nuclear weapon.
Okay, so we're going to take a break and then come back and sort of parse this out a little bit further, because, you know, I think it's kind of interesting to me. I remember when the late Dr. Thomas Van Flandern was living, and along with Dick Hoagland and this whole group, how so many people did such extraordinary research to really prove, based on the artifacts on the surface of Mars, that it's obvious intelligence has been there, an intelligent civilization has been there. I mean, some even suggesting maybe there's something underground. Could life survive under the surface of the Earth, of Mars? So when we come back, we'll take a look at some of the other sort of...
I'll look forward very much to talking about that with you.
Yeah, that's great. We'll come back and we'll start there, because when I was, how old was I? In fourth grade for May Day, we dressed up as Martians. So I have great fondness. We'll be right back. Our guest is Dr. John Brandenburg. He's a plasma physicist, author of Life and Death on Mars, the new Mars Synthesis, but he's got a newer book. We'll be right back.
Hello, this is Tad Buffington, State Director for Maryland and D.C. MUFON. You can hear more about us at www.mufon.com. You are listening to 21st Century Radio with Dr. Zohara Hieronimus, UFOs, and Disclosure, It Will Be Happening.
Welcome back to 21st Century Radio. Dr. John Brandenburg is with us. Among other things, being a plasma physicist, he is author of Death on Mars, Discovery of a Planetary Nuclear Massacre. It's published by Adventures Unlimited, 2015 release. So to summarize for those just joining us on this quarter hour, John, what you said was you believe there was a nuclear war. Would that be appropriate?
I don't think it was accurate to call it a war. It looks like there was a massive nuclear attack on Mars. I think it was one-sided.
Okay.
Just based on the fact that we can't find any evidence of an advanced civilization on Mars, it looks like it was quite primitive, you know, Bronze Age.
And is there concern that whatever spacefaring civilization did this to Mars might do this to Earth?
Well, I'll tell you, I believe in that the law of karma applies not just on Earth, but everywhere else in the universe.
I agree.
I think cosmic karma has caught up whoever did this.
Uh-huh.
This happened like probably maybe 200 million years ago.
Mm-hmm.
About, you know, almost before the dinosaurs.
Fascinating.
And so I think that this happened a long time ago. Whoever did it is long gone.
Mm-hmm.
But the residues remain. And I believe they're looking for the residues now with the InSight lander.
Well, that was what I was going to ask you, because you kind of have been given a green light to go public and tell what you knew, which means
yes,
the U.S. government
I very much was told that they basically wanted me to publish this.
Right. So now the news is out. There was a nuclear disaster on Mars. The civilization was destroyed. We have nuclear weapons.
And Mars the biosphere on Mars was basically destroyed. So Mars could not recover.
Right. Right. And so while we have a dramatic Earth changes beginning on the Earth, we have enough nuclear matter to destroy life on Earth for a pretty good time.
Oh, definitely. We could make ourselves into another Mars if we were foolish enough to do so. And in fact, that's one of the major reasons I did this research, you know, kind of risking my career as a young plasma physicist to get myself involved in this, because I wanted to help end the Cold War. And I published the book Death on Mars because I sense there's a new Cold War brewing between the nuclear powers on Earth.
I think that's very
Russia,
true.
Russia, China, and the United States.
And I
don't want that.
No, I don't either. And I have a question, John, because, you know, when I used to cover politics, which I did for the decade of 1992 to 2002, one of the areas I covered a great deal was China's space ascendancy. And at the time, people thought I was a little wacko. But I kept saying, no, I'm telling you, these guys understand.
Well, anyone who sees into the future correctly is labeled that,
Well, that's true. That's true. So here we have not only the privatization of space, but China, the superpower, headed to the moon, etc. Share with us some of the perspective you and other space community people have, A, about the impact of privatization, and B, the position of China basically saying that, you know, they're going to have space ascendancy.
Well, they
they domination.
They published a book, I think it was China 2050 or something,
yeah,
where they basically said they were going to become the number one military and economic superpower on
right.
Earth. That is their goal.
Yep.
And unfortunately, they published a book where they said this. I mean, the Japanese did something similar before World War II, and of course there was Mein Kampf.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody read those books
mm-hmm.
in the West. But we've actually learned enough to read these books.
Right.
And so now everyone in Washington, D.C. has read these books and think they're going to try and finance their ascendancy to be the number one off of our trade deficit with them.
Right, right.
And stealing technology from us.
Right.
Because apparently they can't invent their own technology. They have to steal it. And, I mean, China has no Chinese scientist living in China has ever won a Nobel Prize for anything.
Mm-hmm.
Chinese scientists living in the United States have won just bushel baskets of Nobel Prizes for chemistry
mm-hmm.
and physics and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a society that encourages innovation, but China has always had a society where if you are a nail, the nail that sticks up will be hammered down, apparently.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm sorry to say this in such graphic terms, but the great geopolitical struggle of the next coming decades is going to be between the United States and China.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
Very clear. I agree with you.
And I recognize that I am a Cold War cowboy.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up during the Cold War. I've been working in national defense since 1975, and I recognize that has, you know, that is kind of in a sense given me a predisposition.
Mm-hmm.
To see things in terms of big geopolitical conflicts, but now I think there's enough evidence that it is actually true that, so the Chinese are now seeking to demonstrate that they have a great space power. They're doing something very innovative, and by the way, I salute the Chinese taikonauts for their bravery and derring do. Just like I salute, you know, Yuri Gagarin and the Russian cosmonauts. Yes, they may be our opponents, but they are certainly brave people. And but the Chinese are now going to try and do something that no one else has done: land a probe on the far side of the moon. And this requires a great deal of you. For one thing, you're out of communication with Earth, direct line of sight, so you have to orbit a satellite in what's called a Lagrange point. Around it's the L2 Lagrange point on the far side of the moon, in order to have communications relay satellite, so you can talk to Earth. So the rover will be able to send pictures back to Earth. They're landing near the South Aiken Basin in a crater called Von Karman, and they'll probably find water there.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. that'll be a great discovery. I was part of the Clementine mission where we discovered large amounts of water at the poles of the moon, including this area that the Chinese are landing. And I salute them if they make a great discovery. This will be wonderful. But it doesn't mask the fact that there's a geopolitical conflict going on now. The human race is just very competitive. It's just, as Harry Truman said, he said, there'll never be peace on Earth because half of the human race is asleep, and the other half that's awake is scheming on how to steal the beds mm-hmm. out from under the people who are asleep.
But, you know, there is the reality, as you pointed out, of karma at the galactic level. I believe that.
Yeah.
That's sort of, it's just, yes, it's not magic, it's just law. And when I think about how many other intelligences there are out there who visit here mm-hmm. and who may be here and have an interest in our not destroying this planet for more reasons than we care. It's also possible that Earth changes will bring the world together, not just to survive the Earth changes, but that there might be wayfaring civilizations who decide, you know, when things get really bad is the time to just get rid of those humans and take the Earth. So I mean, there's so many, you know,
there's been, I'll tell you my understanding of the situation is we live in a universe where we're not alone. As the heroine in my UFO novel says, not only is humanity not alone, we're not even lonely. and she's Chinese American, by the way. She's very clever, but it's my understanding from what I've heard.
Yeah.
That there's 50 different species they've identified out there, and most of them look on the Earth with just benign or amused curiosity.
Mm-hmm.
The universe is basically fairly friendly and just finds us interesting. There's a few bad apples out there, and
that's what I always say. It can't be much.
I decided, by the way, to address all the UFO stuff in science fiction.
Yeah,
because as a scientist, to have a scientific discussion, you have to have real data.
Mm-hmm.
Mars has all this data, but the UFO thing does not have data. It has basically just reports.
So when you say that, I want to come back to the discussion of the moon for a moment. And there's so many theories. Yeah, there's so many theories about, was the moon, designed? Was it engineered? Is it an artifact? Which I don't happen to share that opinion, but there are people who say that.
I know. When they were landing on the moon with the Apollo, they did a very interesting little stunt. They would take the big booster that had boosted the whole Apollo lander and command module to the moon.
Right.
And they would run it into the moon.
Uh-huh. That's what they said.
And ostensibly, this was to give the seismometers that they put on the moon a nice signal. And when they did that, of course, the Earth rang like the moon rang like a bell.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, just indicates that it doesn't have a molten core to speak of. It doesn't mean it's hollow at all.
Wasn't there discussion, though, back in the 50s, as I recall, of the U.S., maybe the USSR, too, exploding a nuclear bomb on the moon?
Oh, yes. Well, they had been setting off bombs in outer space, and one of them was called Starfish, and it lit up the entire Pacific rim. And so they had been launching nuclear weapons into space and blowing them up. But then when they did a test ban treaty, they finally, some kind of adult supervision finally had a say, and they stopped all open-air testing of nuclear weapons.
But what about the time, it wasn't too long ago, when we shot a missile at the moon and it hit? What was that about? I mean, was it like to tell somebody, if you're really up there doing something, we can reach you? I mean, what was that about?
To me, coming from a defense background,
yeah,
it looks like when we were ramming our spent boosters into the moon during the Apollo era, we were sending a message to other people on the moon with seismometers.
That's what I'm saying.
Right, that we could reach them.
That's what it sounds like to me.
I handle this in science fiction, and my science fiction, it's called Morningstar Pass, the collapse of the UFO cover-up.
But do you think that's science fiction, or you think this is real?
There's enough reports. What I did is I put in the novel all the stuff I'd heard around the coffee machine.
Yeah.
And in the hall when I was working in Washington, D.C., at various places. And I told them, I'd really like to write science fiction and can kind of include some of the weird rumors I've heard around here. And my bosses, to my surprise, reacted very positively. John, if you write science fiction, we'll read it.
And not only that, science fiction has always been used by the intelligence community as a way to let information out without saying it's true. Sort of ease it into the subconscious.
Well, I actually got high compliments for my novel. They said, how did you know all this stuff?
Right.
And I said, I just guessed most of it.
Well, so let's sort of look at the big picture. You're in a much better position than I am. I just sit down here in my little earth body and I try to, figure out what the hell's going on. But
you run radio stations, Zoe.
Yes, I understand. But you have insight and information that I don't. And so I'd like to get it from you, because when I if you go onto YouTube and you start looking at all the crazy stuff that's out there and all the stuff being promoted, and you can think, you know, with an open mind, yeah, I can see that some of this might be true, that there is already civilized workers on the moon.
I happen to believe there's a department of generating crazy YouTube videos in some of these
in the CIA. Oh, of course there is. But that's disinformation. That's standard disinformation. That's,
you know, they're putting out as much disinformation as they are.
That's correct. So I come to you looking for your insight based on your real life experience. If there is already a mining operation on the moon, which Inga Swan presumably remote viewed and saw with clarity.
Well, mining operation by who?
That's, well, he didn't know either. He just said bare butt humans. Bare butt humanoids were up there.
I read some of Indigo Swan's work. It was very interesting.
Yeah.
And all I can say is that in my science fiction, I had the Greys have a big base at Mare Muscovans. And I wrote a science fiction trilogy, by the way. I finished this as trilogy. First is the Morning Star Pass, the collapse of the UFO cover-up. Then there's To Rule the Night, which is a euphemism for the moon. And then it's also Overcoming Tragedy.
Yeah.
And then finally is Morning Star Rising.
But when we come back to, I'm sorry, go ahead, finish your thought.
Yeah, I have the Allied powers actually invade the moon.
Well, let's hope
it becomes a ground war on the moon between the aliens and the humans.
But let's come back to just sort of standard, straight fact where we are. China's going to the moon. China is going to, if they are successful, set up a space station, building it with robots, right? And they hope to also build a solar power array. They're talking about launching their own little moon to reflect the light of the sun so that it doesn't cost them much energy.
Heard about this.
Yes, I have heard of this. And you think to yourself, well, isn't that splendid? But what's it going to do to the Earth's biosystems? You know,
there are a lot of details that have been left out. And I think that the Russians actually talked about doing something briefly like this, I remember.
Some sort of reflective
surface. And then they eventually dropped it. And they've done, the Chinese, with a lot of American help, by the way,
right,
have achieved a lot of space accomplishments. We have to hand that to them. Most of the stuff they have done has been done, you know, was done back in the 60s or early 70s by the United States.
Okay. But
the Russians, you know, had the Lunokhod rovers roving around on the moon.
Well, let's add into that what we started to talk about earlier, which is the privatization of space, of people amassing billions of dollars privately.
Yes.
How will that change this whole sort of juggernaut, if you will, of the militarization of space and space dominance by superpowers?
Well, one of the nice things about having a lot of privatization and business is that business people, you know, who make a lot of money, don't like conflicts.
Mm-hmm.
Like the stock market, as you can see, has voted against basically a trade war with China.
Mm-hmm.
And they're sending a message, basically, that we don't want a trade war with China. It'll be bad for business. And that's good. It's good to have somebody saying, hold on, friends, let's have a cup of coffee and sit down and think about this carefully before we anything. And so privatization of space, I think, is a very, very positive thing. And I believe it will lead to everyone having a stake in the peaceful development of space.
Amen
That's
to that.
My belief.
Boy, don't we pray
and
for
I hope
that.
I don't sound hopelessly naive when I say that.
No, I
But I want everyone. I want everyone to get along, and everything to be okay. Amen.
We'll take a break on that cheery note, because I can agree with that. I think it's because we're a year apart, you know, so we think alike. We'll be right back. Our guest is Dr. John Brandenburg. His most recent book, Death on Mars, Discovery of a Planetary Nuclear Massacre, Adventure Unlimited Press, a 2015 release.
Hi, this is Paul H. Smith, former military remote viewer and current remote viewing instructor. My website is www.rviewer.com. And you are listening to 21st Century Radio with Dr. Zohara Hieronimus, metaphysical queen of the airwaves.
Welcome back to 21st Century Radio. Dr. John Brandenburg is with us. If you want to read a fascinating book, I've not had the pleasure of reading it myself yet, Death on Mars, Discovery of a Planetary Nuclear Massacre. It's an Adventures Unlimited 2015 press release. So I want to come back, John, to several things. Backtrack to Eisenhower and thought of nuking the moon. And did they really think that there was an alien force on the moon?
There was... You know, the moon is a very strategic place if you're talking about global military power. And so they thought of the moon as demonstrating a place to demonstrate how much power both sides had. And, you know, it was a chest-beating contest.
Okay.
I'm sorry. It was not exactly the shining moment of the human intellect during the Cold War,
mm-hmm.
especially the early years. Both sides were trying to do stuff that would just impress each other
mm-hmm.
and the rest of the world. And
but here we are now.
And ended up nothing got done. You know, mm-hmm. they didn't set off any hydrogen bombs on the moon. It would have led to a shower of moon rocks, by the way,
yeah.
on the Earth.
Uh-huh. But
So it just like the whole Cold War itself.
Okay,
it
but it wasn't... So that it wasn't like, oh, my God, there's these other species on the moon, alien bases there, and we're going to blow it up. You don't think that was the thinking?
I can't rule that out simply because of what I've heard.
Yeah, I don't
rule it
out.
It's not scientific data, but I've also learned not to discount rumors when I hear them repeatedly.
Right. I mean, it just seems logical to me.
I put them all in my science fiction novel.
All right. Well, I understand that. But from my perspective as just an investigative reporter,
sure.
I look at human nature, and things are pretty simple, actually. And if
they are. And if you're an alien species who want to try and dominate the Earth, you put bases on the far side of the moon.
Exactly. Thank you.
That's what you do.
Exactly. And so that's where China plans to go. They plan to land a rover on the dark side of the moon. And then they do plan...
Now, there's probably a reason we haven't done that ourselves.
Right, because we probably know there's something there.
Well, the Chinese certainly understand cosmic geopolitics, too, I believe. So they may be...
Mm-hmm.
seeing what they can get away with.
Yeah, first man up. Plants their stake and it's their territory. That's right. I have a question about all of that, because I remember Carol Rosen years ago when we interviewed her, I guess it's almost 25 years ago, and we were talking about the trying to make space, you know, a non-militarized area, and of course it is becoming militarized.
I'm sorry, it started out as a military region,
yeah.
and... It's just continued. And, you know, their military, you know, I believe, as a scientist, that we're not alone in the universe. And there are other there's one of the things you see out in space is other military powers.
Right. Right.
The Klingons are out there. The Romulans are out there. I'm just, you know,
I understand.
Alluding science fiction.
No, I appreciate
and,
that.
And so are the Vulcans. And so you can't really talk about demilitarizing space because it's inherently military.
And so then when we move to where we are today with InSight landing on Mars, presumably
yes.
to explore...
And it was launched from Brandenburg Air Force Base.
Okay.
A military site.
Thank you. And they tell us it's to look at the soil and to see how Mars
right.
was formed.
I know just what they're looking for.
So what are they looking for?
They're looking for a very peculiar nuclear isotope called plutonium-244. It has an 80-million-year half-life.
Oh, my God.
And it's not formed in nuclear reactors. It's only formed in hydrogen bombs.
Wow.
Yes. So it will, if they find that in the soil, they discovered it in the residues from the first hydrogen bomb they set off. So if they find that, a large amount of that in the soil on Mars, it will confirm my hypothesis,
mm-hmm.
my theory.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked a friend of mine who was very learned, if they find all of that, I explained all this to him, and he agreed it was an interesting theory, and that would, by the way, you have to launch it from Brandenburg because it's a classified payload.
Okay.
Look for plutonium-244. So you have to have some place where you can guard it 24 hours of mm-hmm. day. And you can't do that at Kennedy Space Force.
That's what they're using for their fuel, the plutonium?
No. They're actually, the plutonium-244 would be found in the soil on Mars.
Okay.
Because they're looking for that, and it has a characteristic gamma rays, set of gamma rays that they put out.
Because I think it was, wasn't it the Cassini?
If they find it, then it confirms my theory.
I hear you. But wasn't the Cassini, as years ago I remember, was a plutonium fuel?
Oh, they had plutonium, like one of the other plutonium isotopes that puts out a lot of heat when it decays.
Yeah.
And they use that as a radiothermal generator.
Got it.
They generate power. And it was very successful. The Cassini and the Voyager, even the Pioneer, what they call RTGs, radiothermal generators, that use this plutonium isotope, are
mm-hmm.
still running.
Interesting. I remember covering, because some of us were a little concerned if there was an accident, all that nuclear. But let's come back.
Well, NASA has tried to get away from using RTGs, but if you go beyond a certain distance from the sun, you can't use solar panels anymore.
Okay.
You have to use an RTG.
Interesting. All right.
Yeah.
So, unfortunately, we're going to run out of time, and there are 1,000 questions I have that I'd love to get at least 3 of them from you, your perspective. All right. So, here we are now. The moon and the Mars are no longer just these places far away. These are places that
They're national security zones.
Amen. I feel that that's the way it's treated, too. And so if we then look at them as national security zones, there are certainly space-voyaging civilizations who aren't going to like our spreading our idiocy to other planets. I mean, we don't behave well. We're not good stewards.
Let me tell you something, Zoe. One of the interesting things about finding evidence for a nuclear massacre on Mars, it basically shows that the human race is not an aberration on the cosmos. It's part of its fabric.
Well, and there's certainly demonstration.
If I'm correct, evil was present in the universe long before there were human beings.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's an interesting way to look at it.
It's part of the fabric of the universe.
The push-pull of what happens.
So, you must realize, there's what's called a principle of mediocrity. It says the human race is fairly average.
Uh-huh. I would agree with that. I mean,
so if you
want to
know what intelligent life in the universe looks like and its behavior and everything like that, just turn on the news. I'm sorry.
Uh-huh.
And the human race, given all of its pluses and minuses, is, according to mediocrity, fairly typical of intelligent life in the universe. And that means that's both good and bad. In fact, one of the heroines of my novel says, she's actually an abductee, and she says, I've met these people from outer space. The good news is they're a lot like us, and the bad news is that they're a lot like us.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, consciousness is what it is, and there's certainly enough demonstration that civilizations rise and fall over billions and billions of years. And we have enough demonstration that there were even billions of years of life on this earth that we don't even talk about. So
So
when you look at this whole dramatic picture, where do you think the average person can put space exploration into their hat so that it makes sense, because I swear, with the internet, I feel like people are getting so pulled away from things that matter into such alarming fear that they're of no use even in their own daily lives.
I know. My son calls half of what's seen on the internet clickbait. It basically has a sensational headline, and the idea is to get you to click on it so they can show you ads.
Yeah, well, that's true. But
and, you know, we have, you know, people talking endlessly about the Twitter sphere, which is not of no importance whatsoever, you know, not to me anyway. And so I believe, though, that the human race is advancing, and we are making progress, even though it doesn't look like it. And that we're going to end up colonizing the moon and Mars in the coming decades.
Yeah, I see the same picture. And it's so interesting. Let us hope at the time.
I believe our future will look like Star Trek. I do.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, it's certainly we've learned, if nothing else, from the intuitive brain, which science fiction often brings us, is that it is, in fact, science fact of the future. And I have found that fairly consistently.
Oh. I've found that writing science fiction is a deeply paranormal experience.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting.
I had things that I wrote that then would turn out to be true.
Yeah.
And there's no way I could have known them.
Yeah.
At the time when I wrote them, and I have the characters come and talk to me.
Yeah, well, I mean, this is actually how intuition works. So who knows what part of consciousness in the universe also wants to help you enlighten the rest. But we are out of time.
Well, I believe the rest of the universe is reaching out to us psychically. I really believe that.
I do, too. See, we agree, John, on just so much. This is just so much fun. We unfortunately have to say goodnight. I have to have you back another time for 2 hours.
Oh my goodness, Zoe. The time flies when you're having fun. It's been so much fun talking to you.
It's been a pleasure. We're going to do it again, and we're not going to wait 10 or 15 years, all right, babe? No way. Good night, everybody.
Happy ever after.
With stimulating talk and breaking news on Talk Radio 680 WCBM, Baltimore, and WCBM.com.